Penguin Random House Audio presents Vulture Peak by John Burdett. Read for you by Stephen Hogan.
Part 1. Chapter 1. In the golden age of conspicuous consumption, it must be more than 20 years ago now, although it seems like only yesterday. Someone rich and famous from Hong Kong built a stately pleasure dome high on a hill in Phuket overlooking the Andaman Sea. They used the finest Thai architects, who produced a lyrical palace with curving roofs under which teak pillars of great girth support high ceilings over vast play areas where pools of limpid blue are linked by tiny streams that tinkle over smooth pebbles selected by a feng shui master, and enormous bedrooms offer ocean views to make you gasp. The developer named the hilltop they had thus colonized Vulture Peak, whether in homage to the Indian mountain upon which the Buddha gave his celebrated sermons, or to the buzzards they had evicted, is unclear. It's as good a place as any for a triple homicide, although access is complicated. I came by taxi, but the driver lost us in a complex of single-lane roads that led to other mansions. We could see the place clearly enough. It's the biggest and swankiest of them all. So, in the end, I climbed up an iron ladder from the sea and have arrived a good 50 minutes after the forensic team, which is led by our senior pathologist, Dr. Supatra, a diminutive figure in white coveralls, mask, and gloves. We press our palms together and wire each other from a distance. She's accompanied by a team of about 8, for the news that is an atrocity of the most serious kind preceded our arrival, and the good doctor likes to be prepared. More than the size of her team, the heavy silence and glum faces, only she and her chief assistant are wearing masks, portend a crime scene lurid with bad luck. Not a one of us will not spend an hour or so making merit in a temple before the day is out. In my mind's eye, I stand before a Buddha image with a bunch of smoking incense and bow 3 times. Dr. Supatra leads me to the master bedroom, where 3 human forms lie on a giant bed. In an attempt to minimize the bad joss as much as to express respect for the dead, Supatra has covered them from head to toe with an equally extravagant white sheet. She pauses for a moment before inviting me to share the labor of removing it. The rest of her team have wandered in to observe my reaction. The Buddha taught that the distinction between subject and object, the self and other, even between you and me, dear Farang reader, may I call you D.F.R., is illusory. This lesson is brought home with perhaps more drama than the master intended when the human forms before you have been stripped of faces, eyes, genitals, and, as the good doctor indicates by pointing to gaping wounds in each cadaver, kidneys and livers too. To call them anonymous would be to evade the issue. Stripped of every vestige of personal identity, they are all of us, as anyone knows who has ever flown economy. With so much surgery to absorb, it takes me a moment to notice that the finger and thumb tips of each victim have been snipped off. Supatra follows my gaze. Any first impressions regarding cause of death? I ask.
Gunshot wounds to the back of the head. A single shot in each case. Everything points to a carefully planned execution prior to pillaging the bodies for organs.
Obviously no print identification, I mutter. DNA?
The doctor shrugs. If any of them committed a serious crime over the past 5 years, maybe. We only have DNA records for convicted criminals.
But prints could have been checked on the National ID Bank. I shake my head.
Someone is being unusually shy about who they killed. We have to go on the likelihood they were all Thai residents who could have been identified if they still had fingertips.
I scratch my jaw.
That leaves 60 million possibilities.
Supatra allows herself a smile bordering on the coquettish.
I may be able to help, Detective.
Just last week, I sent off for some fancy software that will allow us to reconstruct the faces on my laptop. The government won't pay, so I'm buying it myself.
Really? That will be helpful. By the way, what genders are the victims?
2 men and a woman.
Now I notice something else. No blood?
Somebody cleaned up meticulously. They even used some chemical that neutralizes our tests. I tell you, whoever did it were professionals. There were certainly more than one.
I nod.
Any ideas?
The doctor asks when we've replaced the sheet. You mean who done it? Only in the more general sense. She raises her eyes. Ronald Reagan, Milton Friedman, Margaret Thatcher, Adam Smith. Capitalism done it. Those organs are being worn by somebody else right now. She stares at me for a moment and, good Buddhist that she is, shivers.
Oh, yes. Of course I saw that from the start.
I leave her in the infinite lounge to step out onto the balcony, which offers a plummeting vista of rocks and ocean of the kind that invariably provokes thoughts of suicide in even the healthiest psyche, and fish out my cell phone to call my assistant, Lek. I ask him to go straight to the Phuket Land Registry and give him the address of the crime scene, which should be enough for the registry to work out the lot number. I don't bother to check the rest of the house. What's the point? Despite my evasive answer to the doctor's question, I already know too much. I need to clear my head and my heart. I also need to consider how to break the news to my partner, Chanya. All of a sudden, I need to do a lot of things that form no part of crime detection. The iron ladder I climbed up starts at a corner of the balcony and hugs the massive rock all the way down. I jump the last 2 steps to land on soft shale that releases an inelegant sea stench, which I suck in with some relief. Despite the impossible heat, I decide to follow the shore all the way back to the main road. I'll find a cab or a motorbike taxi there. Lek, a transsexual permanently on the verge of the operation that will equally permanently turn him into a woman, is waiting outside the thoroughly modern land registry. A refugee from the glacial air conditioning that our bureaucrats have come to expect as a perk of their employment. He shivers as I open the door for us, and we are braced by an arctic breeze.
The clerks are katoi,
he complains. Katoi means transsexual, which is to say, one of his own tribe. Is it too early in the narrative for a dark observation of the human condition? Namely, that to know well is often to loathe well. To put it another way, the fishwife inside all men is liberated when the ghoulies are cut off, or about to be. But he's right. The clerk is a katoi of the kind who did not find consummation after the operation. Dark, paranoid eyes seem in endless doubt as to whether life without a cock is even worse than with one. When I ask politely if he cannot find the lot number of the address I give him, it is, after all, the biggest, most prominent, most overblown mansion on the highest rock in the locality, Lek interjects loudly with faux hurt.
I already asked him exactly that question, and he said, "What do you think I am, a private detective?"
I catch the clerk's eye and smile glacially as I present my police ID. Caught, he goes into a classic katoi sulk. It's the full show with pouted lips, tuts, and well, I supposes. But he magically finds the logbook under the desk. He must have retrieved it from the shelves while Lek was outside sheltering from the cold. Perhaps fearful that I will make a formal complaint, he tuts and frets his way through the pages until he finds the lot we are seeking. He also runs his finger down the column that records the various parties who have owned the pleasure palace over the years. It seems that a famous and now deceased Hong Kong Chinese woman, the widow of an equally famous land development tycoon, bought the lot through a local company without disguising her identity. This we may take as an act of flamboyance, proving she was so rich she didn't much care if one day she would have to pay tax on the resale, or, more likely, that she would one day be cheated by her Thai shadow shareholders. On her death, the property was...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.